Okay, I'll go ahead and get started now. My name is Pete Hussler, and I'm with the UPSD project. My day job is I'm a network administrator, so I run a network for a hosting provider based in Germany. And I'll be talking to you about a protocol that we are enjoying and like a bit. It's called a bidirectional forwarding detection. So I recently implemented this within UPSD. And so I want to tell you that. First, I need to kind of describe some background so you can really understand what BSD is actually doing. So routers deliver packets, and they have to choose where they have been delivered. Routers only know the next router that it should send to. So we have a router, and it goes from router A to router B. We have to check, is it usable? Is it a valid route for us? The way it works internally is that we check the RTF ups, is the route marked as up. Now, some of you who are working on the internals of the routing table, there may be some slight inaccuracies, but I'm trying to simplify it for administrators, people utilizing this. So yeah, so we check, is the gateway up. Before BFD, what you do is you monitor the link state of the connection. So your connection from one router to another router is simply an Ethernet cable of some type. It can be copper, so there power being sent over. Is it a fiber optic connection? Do you see lights from the other side? That's not always a reliable way of checking if the link is actually up. It's very reliable to check it down. If you have no connection, clearly it can't work. But even if you have a connection, it doesn't mean the machine, the other router, is capable of forwarding packets for you. Sometimes there are other active devices that do their own, that provide their own power or their own link for this. A very common case would be a switch. Certain types of long-range connections, like if you want to go over 40 kilometers, they will still provide light, even though the other router is just not working. And of course, there are certain types of crashes where, like, if the kernel is in live lock, it'll keep the links up, even though it cannot actually process it. On a router, you typically use a protocol called BGP to communicate the routes. But available in that, I'm a router, I'm up, I can do stuff, this is what I can handle. BGP includes a timer for checking the health of the other system. It just says, hi, I'm still here. Your typical keep alive timer for this is 90 seconds. So you send hello, I'm alive every 30 seconds. If you lose three of them, then the machine's considered dead. So how much traffic is that actually when it's a 10 gigabit link? 90 seconds of 10 gigabits is a lot of data. What if it's 100 gigabits? What if that link is being used for voice over IP? 90 seconds of dead time on a telephone call, you're going to have some very, very angry people. And if one of those people is your CEO, you might need to update your CV and go find a new job. The BGP spec the whole time is defined in seconds. So fast as possible within 3 seconds. Harder routers usually have less computing power than a box of cereal, and so they cannot actually handle doing keep alive that fast. What about OSPF? What about LDP? What about all these other protocols? If each of the ones that you're using sends their own independent keep alive over this at hyper fast rates for fast failover, that's a lot of traffic. You're going to eventually fill up several megs or even more just with hello, I'm alive traffic. And that can get kind of expensive, especially if you're paying per megabit for your link, as it is pretty traditional at these data rates. So BFD is two standards. The first one is RFC 5880, and that describes the actual protocol itself. detects faults between two forwarding devices. Those are not defined, what kind of device they are. Kind of irrelevant. Most people don't utilize them as a router, which can use it pretty much anywhere. An interesting thing is that 5880 is only the contents of a protocol. It's not actually the wrapper and how it's delivered. That's defined in 5881, which is just a single UDP packet in either IPv4 or IPv6. Because of the separation, you can do really clever things, like you can have BFD packets encapsulated within LDP for checking your MPLS network, within individual links of a bonded pair, like a trunk interface or LACP. So you can actually check the health of each of those links. And there's a variety of other options of ways that you can encapsulate BFD. So it's found on big routers, Juniper, Cisco, Brocade, etc. In the research in the wild that I've seen, it's most commonly used with BGP or MPLS, which can also be kind of described as BGP. In the spec, they use microseconds, which is the seconds, and not MS. So it's a million times a second. And so you can detect extremely fast when there's an outage. As an implementation detail of OpenBSD, we're not going to support timers faster than 50 milliseconds. That's still incredibly fast, but we want to be able to make sure we can actually forward traffic. In our kernel, we still have a tick, and the tick that runs usually runs at worst every 10 milliseconds. So we want to make sure that we're not claiming to support something that we just can't actually do. There's two modes of how BFD works. First one is async. I send keep alive, you send me a reply. You send me keep alive, I send you a reply. Pretty standard, this works the same way most keep alive protocols work. Certainly. There's also a demand mode, which is simply defined as it's out of band. Occasionally, periodically, you may send this traffic. The way most vendors implement it is they monitor traffic counters. They know that the BFD protocol is on a certain link. It goes out, for example, EN1, and it connects to a router directly connected. And so it knows that when it receives traffic on EN1, that, the other machine must still be alive because we received traffic. So they monitor the traffic counters, and they monitor the data plane. And if there is no traffic for, say, 100 milliseconds, then it sends the BFD to keep alive. Are you there? This can be a very clever way to monitor a busy link, because if it's busy, you don't want to set add more traffic to it. But if it's not, but if it suddenly becomes not busy, or it's just a nighttime low peak, then you just still send your own health packets. Like all specs and all standards, there's a lot of stupidity, actually. So this is in 5881 for the actual IPv4, IPv6, UDP encapsulation. The source port must be in this range. By the way, Juniper actually checks that. That was one of the failure modes when I was developing this against one of our Junipers in the lab. They actually checked that. The sort port number should be unique amongst all BFD sessions. The number of distinct uses of the same source port should be minimized. It's a source port. Who cares, right? And my favorite part is the last sentence. But ultimately, the mechanisms in the actual 5880 must be used to demultiplex incoming packets. So do this, but who cares? But sadly, that one is actually followed pretty closely. And so that is all. That is not the entire ephemeral port range. It's only the high ephemeral port range. So you need to manually specify that. I just said, here's your range. Choose one randomly and deal with it. I don't care about, in my implementation, I don't care at all if I reuse the same port number. In the actual, so remember that we have to use the mechanisms in the 5880 to determine how to choose which session this belongs to. The discriminator field is actually that mechanism. You have a discriminator where it's some number that you choose, you put in the packet, you send the packet, the remote side copies that field into the spec, and into their packet, and send that back to me. That's how I do this. You can change it without affecting the session state. What that means is we don't care.
Yes, clean up your own mess, and then it's fine.
Yeah, it's clean up your own mess, and maybe it works. The implications, yeah, so you're allowed to do so, but what that means is who cares. They have a authentication session method. So the actual protocol itself is a very simple binary protocol. It's completely open, and there is no unique values in it. There's no security, there's no encryption or anything like that. They do have an optional section where you can give what they call authentications, and they are hashed in some way, usually. So in the authentication section, it's the type, the length, a sequence number, and then the encrypted value that you're supposed to check. And the encrypted value is normally the hash of the entire packet, including the sequence number. They have two types of authentication for each of the hash algorithms, keyed and meticulously keyed. Meticulously keyed, you must increase the sequence number for every packet you transmit. Which means for the non-meticulously keyed, you're not required to actually change the sequence number. So I made you replay protection, then I gave it. The common use, the keyed SHA-1 is much more in use than the meticulously keyed SHA-1. So yeah, great. This is pretty useful as a way to prevent replay attacks. And unfortunately, SHA-1 is the best of the available encryption methods. There is no better algorithm defined in their standards. Not even in the drafts. So what is the current status of this? It's committed. It's an OpenBSD. There are two parts of it, parts of the kernel to actually do the protocol itself. Then there's the userline part to manipulate and view and to see what is going on. It was enabled for around a month, maybe a month and a half. So our work in the SMP, trying to make our entire network stack SMP safe. I was using a little used feature that became kind of difficult, so we disabled BMP to not block the rest of unlocking the network stack. Hopefully I'll be able to get this enabled in time for the 6.1 release, but we'll see. Discussions are going on. I'm still actively working on this. It is getting a few more improvements and future work that I'll be talking about later. I've implemented all the musts. I've looked over, I've implemented a few of the shoulds. I haven't been interested in dealing with because they're silly and bizarre. I've done successful negotiations against many other vendors of routers. As I said earlier, we have a Juniper MX-AV within our own lab. tested it against Cisco hardware, against Brocades, Extreme Networks, three or four other vendors. So it does work against real products in the wild. Each of them have been up for at least 5 days. So that is definitely, from a protocol level, very solid, very nice log. We have basic logging. It provides route messages over the router socket, so you can actually see state changes as it happens. I'll go into a little bit more of that later. The way it's implemented is using the SOSend-SOC. So that is just normal traffic. The same way you would do send and receive. Basically the same mechanisms. And this means that it's after PF. So you can actually lock the BFD messages using your PF rules, depending on how closed you want to make your rule set. It's pretty common for a lot of routers. You do block it to self, pass in ICP, pass in BGP, passing protocol BGP, done. You do that, then your BFD will never come up because you're blocking those ports. So you'll just need to kind of pay attention to your PF rules if you need this. Right, that was from a different time I gave this talk where I had changed quite a bit of it, so. Right, so what we do in the, so this is how you do it. Basically you have your destination machine. Currently we only support being directly connected. We do not support multiple hops yet. So you have to change the route to your destination. You have to add BFD, and then this is how it shows up. It's a directly connected route. Post route, it's up, local, and then we add this capital F, which means BFD is involved. And then so here we see that check the BFD, then we see all the BFD configuration and runtime options. So in this case, the async mode, we think we're up, the remote side thinks that we're up, the previous state that we were in is down, what's the current error counter, our diagnostics, what the remote side told us of the diagnostics, we have our chosen discriminator, what the remote side thinks the discriminator is, with the uptime, how long we spent in the last state, and here is the timers, and that it's a multiple of three, so it's only three packets to go on. So we also have routing socket messages from state change. So this is that's visible within route monitor, where you see the RTM BFD. So we have our own routing message for that, so we can filter forward. You can filter out if you don't care. And this is just the new states, and then it has all the details of that. This is the other side, just the output of the Juniper that I'm talking to. Here's my discriminator that I sent them. It's not important to look at this on the slide. The slide that will be posted online 10 minutes after talk ends, so you can look at those details. So that's the current status of BFD. There is more work I want to do. So currently the way that the OpenBSD writing table works is that we don't directly check the up or down state of a routing entry. Because our writing table was original from the 80s, MPI, Monte Cristo, has done a lot of work in bringing it up to the 90s now. And then he's planning to move it actually to this century relatively soon. That's a lot of his ongoing work. So what I would like to do is be able to actually manipulate the up and down state. So that way your statically created graphics will then just simply do the correct magic that you monitor against a neighbor and you see that the neighbor doesn't work. Those routes will be marked as invalid, and then the kernel fib routing table will then just redirect based on its normal route selection algorithm. As silly as the authentication stuff is, I actually kind of want to support it, so that way we can connect against neighbors that kind of require a match to be available. I don't think you're going to gain anything. I personally wouldn't use it if I don't have to. But there are times when you're dealing with another organization where they require this. Yeah, let's not make it difficult, more difficult than it needs to be to interoperate with other people. About 2 months ago, they came up with a new RFC called Seamless VFD, which cleans up a lot of the issues that it originally had. I have not yet looked at it, and I want to finish up 5880 before I get working on the next one. So I'd really like to look at that. And then there is a multi-path, or multi-hop is probably more accurate, where you can go, so normally it's only directly connected, but you can check against a remote host using multiple paths to it. You can require, oh, this path must be checked, and this path, and this path. So you can do, you check. Probably the best use of this would be your three transit internet providers. So you send out the packets across them and check the health of, oh, can I connect to Netflix over, you know, Comcast or AT&T or IIJ, and which one is reliable so I can watch my streaming without outages. I also want to add, so as I mentioned earlier, there we have routing messages that tell us when state changes. And so the routing daemons can really utilize this information. It can be very powerful for it. And that's kind of the origin of this concept, is you monitor your neighboring router, speaking of BGP, and then I just check the next hop, the IP address of my neighboring router and check the health of it. When it goes down, BGP really should notice that the remote site is down and tear down the sessions immediately. So that way the new routing calculation happens much faster and your outages are much shorter. So yeah, I would like to add this to BGP. OSPF, EIGRP, those are your basic IPv4, IPv6. I'd really like to look at supporting this within LDP, which handling the MPLS side. Doing BFD over your MPLS labels, you can also have your MPLS network fail a lot faster. Then of course, within SwitchD, which is an open flow controller that can be very helpful for controlling your external other parts of your network. There is a standard for BFD within VXLAN. VXLAN is a way to kind of extend your VLAN, your layer 2 domains across the network. This way you can check whether or not the remote site is available. And then this scary set of letters is the entire reason I got, personally, I got interested in this. This was a draft, I believe from 2015, that was published and partially written by people from DKIX, the German Internet Exchange. It depends on how you count, the largest in the world. And what this draft is, it's my BTP router tells the route server, I support BFT. And then another member of the exchange, who's also on the route server, goes, I also support BFT. And then before I accept their routes as valid and use the engine to start sending them traffic, we automatically set up and configure a BFT session against each other. What this does is this prevents a classic case of the control plane separated from the VM. There have been instances in the past, there's been some pretty large internet outages because of that, where everyone still had their session to the route servers up, but the switches connecting them didn't have the bandwidth or didn't have actually any connectivity between them. So everyone still got their KeepAlive. And everyone still thought the other side was up, but your black hole of traffic has been dropped somewhere, you don't know where. But all your health checks think that they're up. And since BFD always flows over the data plane, this draft guarantees the health check of that data plane, but it does not require any manual configuration of this, so it just pops up automatically. And if someone running a decently sized BGP network, that would be very exciting. I like having automatic configurations. I like not having to worry about it. I like having them all health checks. So, that's it. I think I went reasonably fast. Caught up on time. Does anyone have any questions? Alright, so async is just you send the packet, you receive the packet, normal KeepAlive. Demand is the routers decide when they should send the packets. It's not on your standard timers. It's just whenever we decide we want to. And most of them are just monitoring traffic structures. So if the remote router is sending us traffic. And if we receive traffic from the remote router, either we check it with the MAC address or that's a point link or whatever, then we know the remote side is up. So we don't need to send KeepAlive. Are you still awake? Yes, it is. But then after the way most vendors are implementing it is they have a little timer where if they haven't received traffic for some period of time, then they send a single async KeepAlive. Are you alive? Yes, I am. Yeah, it's just a way of not overloading the entire session.
So, I think most of it's I implemented in the current.
Yes. Yes, most of it is implemented in the kernel. We're directly manipulating the routing table, or at least we plan to be directly manipulating the route's states, with up and down. And so that's one reason why we want to be in the kernel. Another reason is because we want to be in the same layer as the actual forwarding path. And because of latency and performance reasons. So as I said, like we have to run under 50 milliseconds. That's pretty fast. We don't want to come up through the kernel to use LAN, do stuff, and then come back out.
Okay,
so
the rest part is just
the
that's it, correct?
Yeah,
to take a look at the graph message.
Correct.
And react on the
Yeah, so daemons that care, which in this case are the riding daemons, they care about if the next hop is still accessible and available, then they will walk to this. Once I implement the actual once I actually manipulate the up and down state, then the riding demons don't strictly need to know this anymore. They'll just get the message from the kernel, oh, this IP is no longer valid, and then they will just do their own. They'll just recap it on their own. All of the riding demons already have support. For example, if you just unplug the Ethernet interface, or if you lose link, that just shows up as a if down. And so it goes, okay, the interface is down, the next hop IP is no longer valid, you recount it. And so once BFD can actually manipulate the up and down states, then daemons that only want to react, but otherwise don't care, can just do that. BGP will want to set this, want to monitor this, want to have a lot more knowledge about how BFD is reacting to its neighbor. So BGP will get kind of more expensive support for BFD. So you would need to implement this within Dragonfly, of course.
Yes. Can I use OpenBSD as the other side so I can?
Yes. Yes.
Yes, absolutely. The only part I think you mentioned is authentication, right?
Right.
Except for the authentication recipe, it's just in the
So we support all of the musts.
All the musts, yeah.
Yeah, all the musts. Like, we are fully compliant with the standard. The authentication part is a should. Yeah. It is not required, thankfully. If you do support it, you're not required to utilize it. It's just an option in the configuration. I personally just did it against Juniper because that's what I had in my lab. I have not personally tested it, but there is a Usaline daemon for Linux. Bird has support as well.
Bird supports using the Usaline, pure Usaline.
Yep. But it has they have their own implementation.
They have their own, so I can also test it against the Bird.
Yes. I'm not sure if that works on the BSDs. I know for sure it works on Linux. Yakta, Arista, and the other kind of software virtualized routing platform. The other virtualized routing platforms, they have support for this, so you can use those in your lab as well. I was very happy once I got more than just one other type to be tested against. Yes, it's keep alive is just like that's what the BGP message is called, that's what GRE is. It's kind of a relatively common term within that aspect of the industry. And it's just a hello, I'm here.
Is it common for the echo to be dropped by the intermediate devices, for example, dropped by the switch?
It is extremely unlikely.
Because you are mixing the request and the echo with the isolated traffic, right?
This is UDP traffic.
Yeah, but it's going to use the normal traffic as well.
Yes. But that is intentional. So that way you can tell if the remote side, or if any of the middle, if overloaded or whatever. So if it's the 1 gigabit link and you're sending a full gigabit of traffic over it, yes, you'll have some packet loss and maybe, hopefully, the BFD packet will be dropped, and then that link will then be brought back up, or that link will be brought down if the packets are being dropped. And also with the errors, the individual, you'll get a route message for every error that happens, even if it's still considered healthy. I mean, three errors would tear it down, but if you get one error, you want to know. And for BGP, for example, you can go, I've gotten one error every 10 seconds for 30 minutes. Maybe I'll bring down the link. So under the BFD protocol, losing one packet every 10 seconds is perfectly valid. You have to lose three in a row, which you tear down the session. But BGP or your monitoring software, they really care about that. So you can make other decisions based on this. So that's why we're setting that up much more.
Okay, so the routing message is only triggered, for example, when you send the passive packet to receive the echo?
The routing messages are only sent on state change, which includes the error counter changing.
But if you change counter timeout, you also send the routing message up?
Yes. Yeah, so timeout on the receive, we send one. If the remote side sets down, we send one. During the negotiation protocol, we send four for the various states of down, and up.
Diet and wave at the same.
I'm sorry?
Diet and wave at the same.
Yes. Yeah, and when you manually enable it and disable it, then we send a message as well.
But if the request and echo is successful, then you don't send the message.
Correct. If it's healthy, no matter what writing message is. You want to see the running message when there's something different. And so if the other machine is down, you get error 1, 2, 3, no more. You don't see running messages, that we're still down, we're still down, we're still down, we're still down, we're still down. Because again, that's just too many. The state has changed, things happen, now we see. To create it allows you to choose your own values, but the route command does not occur. It's not supported, actually.
Okay, so you can actually choose your own for the on demand and sync.
Yeah.
Right. Or is it negotiated?
That's negotiated.
Other sides send you async, then you must use async?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, if you have a side send you async, then.
What's the default mode?
The default mode is async.
I think.
Yeah, we should just keep live async. More questions? All right, thank you.